My name is Derek. I'm a VSO English volunteer working within the Directorate of Forestry. I was asked by an organisation called ODA to see if we could set up a beekeeping project in Namibia. Seems a strange sort of thing to be asked to do, but the reason that we're trying to set up a beekeeping project in Namibia is that Namibia is probably one of the last countries in Africa without any real culture of beekeeping. Man has had a long history of exploiting bees, and honey is considered to be the food of the gods. And people in Namibia certainly do like honey, but the tradition up to now has been of honey hunting. Unfortunately, this isn't a sustainable method, and it results very often in the bees dying. Right, we're now in the former Damaraland area, and this is a traditional beekeeper called Manasseh, and for me this is an amazing discovery. This is the first time that I've actually come across any sort of sustainable traditional beekeeping while I've been in Namibia. And just to the back of me here is the entrance to a colony of bees. I don't know whether you can see this, but there's a stone in the entrance, and these stones mark the site of the traditional beekeeper so other people don't harvest honey from this site. And this has been passed on to Manasseh from his ancestors, and it shows, you know, this is a really good example of sustainable beekeeping. Once a year Manasseh comes to this site and he smokes the entrance of the beehive, removes the stone and the crop of honey, but he doesn't destroy the whole bee's nest, and that can he makes sure that that is there and there's sufficient honey stores for the bees to continue year after year. And it's absolutely amazing. And now Manasseh is going to show us how we can traditionally harvest the honey. That's an incredible noise, the bees echoing in the chamber.
I'm going to go to the house. tani daki samki dasi u ni ran amaku kita je koru daku kita je kacira tani tua je daki al daki di si kubudun kena kubudun kena tu nak dijen kubu.
My job is to assess the feasibility of beekeeping in Namibia. I've been working in the north of Namibia primarily because this is a higher rainfall area and we consider it to be a more viable venture in the north. It's not easy. It's not easy to introduce beekeeping into Namibia. There are several climatic conditions and the drought affects the way the bees behave. Some years it will be very difficult to take any honey crop away. Other years there might be a good honey crop. And some years you might have to be pragmatic and think, well, the bees are there for purely pollination purposes. We're now driving through Atavi and we're going to visit a project that's run by the Swapo Veterans Trust. This project was one of the first ones that we helped to set up, and we're trying to incorporate three different types of hive design. We introduced three types of beehives. First of all, we transferred some bees from Okahania to Atavi in a Langstroth beehive. This is a modern beehive that we had to import from South Africa. It has the advantage of being mobile, and we can transport bees from one place to another, which we need to do because of the shortage of bees in Namibia at the moment. It's very expensive and not really appropriate in any other way other than the mobility. One of the problems that we have got here is large hive beetles. And this particular beehive, they get large hive beetles going in the front. And they eat the brood, lay their eggs, and the bees have got no defence against them. First of all, we brought some bees in the modern Western beehive, the Langstroth that we've seen. And then what we wanted to do was have a simpler one. So we had this design called the Kenyan Top Bar Beehive. And these are the top bars. And it's got slanted sides. Is the one? It's got these slanted sides, you see? Mm-hmm. So that the comb will not seal onto the sides. That's the advantage of the slanted sides. But it's made of, a man makes these for us in Bushmanland, yeah? And they're very, very good quality in beehives. But they still cost $110. And we think that communities, it'll still be too expensive. So we were still looking for a simpler design. But this is a lot better than the Langstroth. Shit. You gather I got one then. Yeah? Occupational hazard, eh? There's a sting there, you see? And you don't pull it out because you press the poison in. You just scrape off the sting like that.
and then it saves all the poison going in.
We've now tried a cheaper design called the sunken top bar beehive. The reason we're trying this is that it's free from predators, and also it's nice and cool being in the ground. So we're trying to mimic those things that the bees like, and this is why we've built this concrete beehive that's sunken into the ground. And after 2 years of work, we've now got a hive design that's costing more like $30 or $40 instead of $110.
Right. Oh, that's good, eh? Yeah, can you just here with the smoke of them? Move them out of the way. And a few. And then move it. Yes, that's the idea. And then lift it up. That's good. Yeah, that's right.
To find bees in Namibia has been extremely difficult, and we've had to try and collect colonies from wherever we can find them. People's houses, in army bases, we found them in Mahangu stores. In fact, everywhere where bees have been reported, we've tried to transfer them into beehives.
I'd like to introduce you to Natalie and Samuel. These are two people that live in a village near Umbalantu. They've asked us out here because they've got bees in this Mahangu basket, and they've been unable to use the Mahangu for the last couple of years because the bees keep chasing them away, and they've asked us to come and remove them. Yeah. Right, now you can see the Mahangu basket with the roof removed. We're about to take the plastic sheet off and see what's inside. Oh, there's a drone there, so there's still some drones left. Oh, look at that. Wow. Oh my God, this is bigger than I thought it was. Oh well. We'll be here a bit longer than I expected. So we'll put some smoke on the bees. And you'll see some drones flying about, the big drones.
Combs were a bit too big to fit in the box. The CO door is going to have a bit of a go now.
This big one.
Keep doing one every time. It's a big one, yeah. Hold it and cut it. Make sure you don't drop it.
Now we'll smoke them out, yeah?
Yeah.
I'll put some smoke in and drive most of these out.
We're going to try and catch these bees and transfer them possibly to the Neoma school at Oshikuku to try and strengthen the bees that are already there and turn again a problem into an advantage.
Good morning, everybody. right, I think today is a very exciting day for me. because as you know, there was a big problem with the bees in the school, in the dining room, and I was invited to come and get rid of them. Bees were living up in the roof and they were dropping down in between the cracks, and they were chasing all the children about during lunchtime. So this was a big problem. But it caused so much interest that people have said, you know, could we fetch the bees back again in a controlled way? And so it turns a problem into an advantage, yes? I'd like to introduce you to Theodore Kaumba, who is now working with me. He's the beekeeping extension officer for the whole of the former Awambaland area, right? And is working within the Directorate of Forestry. With the help of several people in the school, we've made this very low-cost beehive, a cement beehive, with top bars on. And these are the top bars. They have to be exactly 32 millimetres wide. And that is the only technical little bit of information about the beehive, yeah? Slowly. There we are. This one. That is a little bit of, this is honeycomb. It is made from beeswax. And it is a valuable product, as well as other products. You know the products from the beehive? There's honey, beeswax, you can get pollen, and there's a product called propolis, which is an antiseptic that you can get from the beehive, yeah? So you can pass that to Paulus. Try not to trap the bees. You can put a little bit of smoke on, you see there, and it will just drive them down, yeah? So you're not killing any. Never kill bees, because they are valuable. This is a smoker. There is a skill in using the smoker. If you puff it hard, then the bees will start to become defensive, and it worries them. But if you just do nice, gentle smoke, then that will calm the bees down, right? And this is a matter of skill. You will learn the skill, right? So. Okay. Now this is interesting. Can you see this patch here?
Yes.
This is brood, the babies. So that tells us there must be a queen somewhere here. Yes. What can you see on that side, Paulus? And I think this is brood here. Can you see? Honey on the outside, and brood in the middle, and just workers. Oh, look at this one. Can you turn it and show the people the queen? Would everybody like to see the queen bee?
Yes.
Okay. I will. I've lost it. Where are we? There's the queen bee, you see? An interesting thing about the bees here is that the children have had no experience with the bees whatsoever. I can tell you they were quite frightened about them initially, and we tried to reassure the children that the bees would be okay. Can I ask you a question? Are you surprised that the bees are not stinging? They are nice and quiet? Yeah? Did you expect them to be chasing you? No. Okay, that's good. You believe me. Not many people do. We're in a town called Tasandi, and this is one of the largest examples of a baobab tree we found in the region. It's called Sir Howard, after the original commissioner of Southwest Africa. If you climb up here, you can see some huge cavities in the tree where bees, honeybees, build their traditional nests. There's two colonies of bees in the tree at the moment, and there is well-recorded history where people traditionally used to come and climb these baobab trees and take out the honey in a sustainable way without destroying the bees' nest. Here at Ogongo Agricultural College, students study forestry and agriculture, and we've set up a demonstration apiary to show the students the benefit of bees.
To tell you the importance of keeping bees, why we have to keep bees, then what we are going to do is to demonstrate for you to take this from this Kenyan top bar to the concrete top bar hut.
To find out if beekeeping in Namibia is really viable, we decided to set up a series of demonstration apiaries. This is a collection of beehives where we'll be able to find out if beekeeping really works, and if it does, we can extend it into the communities by asking people to come in and look at our examples.
On eggs, you can come across and see. Yes.
It's essential when introducing beekeeping into Namibia to consider the most appropriate methods. We've had some tremendous help in Namibia from Namibians, and at Ambulantu Rehabilitation Centre, for example, people have helped us to try and manufacture an appropriate bee suit.
I've just come here today to thank you very much for making me these hats for beekeeping.
The hats have been made in the former Vambaland area near Andangwe by a local person, and we've made a bee suit that's quite appropriate and cheap.
And they are very good.
And now we've got the cost around down to in the region of about $30-$35.
We're now visiting Emily's vegetable project in Oshakati. I was really excited when I met Emily because she was one of the few Namibians I'd met who really already knew the value of bees. She'd worked hard at developing her project, and she's got a lot of fruit trees, guava, bananas, apples, papaya, sugar cane. She grows a lot of different fruit trees. And as you'll see, the bees have made a significant contribution to her fruit project. The most important thing to her is that the bees are in the garden to pollinate the fruit trees and can make a big significant difference to her fruit crops, 10 or 15%. Emily knew that. I didn't have to tell her a lot about that. She knew the value of the bees, and the honey is a secondary factor in her case, I think. I first met Marcus at Agongo Agricultural College when we attended an agroforestry meeting. I was requested to show the people the beehives, and it caused a lot of interest amongst the people attending the course. I was amazed to find out later that Marcus Muti had returned to his home at Unkurunkuru, and he made his own beehive just from seeing the beehives on one occasion. He made his own top bar beehive.
They provided you with some bees, and this is my gift to you. So that I don't think that you need to worry about any payment. So in future, if you want any more top bars, you can buy them from Magdalena at $1 each. The hat from Awambaland.
Yeah.
And then this has been sewn on Nakayali near Ambalantu.
Oh, yeah.
And then you put this on, and you've got your overalls.
I'm really, really pleased that I've managed to meet Marcus and with somebody with that sort of enthusiasm and do some extension work. I think this is a very important part of the job, is to try to get some extension. And the way extension work works, if beekeeping is going to work in Namibia, then it's by people like Marcus, who are leaders in a sense. They have the enthusiasm, and if it works, if he gets good crops of honey and he can demonstrate to his friends around the local community that beekeeping does work, then they'll try that. There'll be a natural progression, and that's sometimes the best way of extension projects ever working. So I'm really quite excited about that, and I'm sure Marcus will go on and be a good beekeeper. Well seen, lass. It's very nice to see you again. You're about the only person that I know that can make these top quality top bars, but it's very important to our beekeeping project. But these top bars that you make from the Pterocarpus angulensis are the best ones anywhere in Namibia. And if forestry is going to keep promoting beekeeping, we definitely need you to keep making them for us. They're the best quality without a doubt. They don't bend, they don't twist, and your handmade ones are as good as any that you can get made with a machine. So thank you very much for that. We're now at Hamoi. This is a Directorate of Forestry's research centre near Rundu, and this is going to be the headquarters of the beekeeping department. We needed a headquarters for two reasons. One reason is that usually Rundu is an area of high rainfall, and two, we needed a centre where we could service all the rest of the demonstration apiaries. Theodore is going to be the beekeeping extension officer for the former Awamba land area, going perhaps from Sumer right up to Ruakana. And Magdalena is the beekeeping officer, and if Theodore needs some managerial support, he can come to Magdalena, who will be based here, to get that. I shall hand over to Magdalena, who can explain a little bit about the centre now.
Thank you very much, Derek, for your introduction. Having the beekeeping centre in the Okavango region doesn't mean beekeeping business is only practiced in the Okavango region. But this is only the centre. We are trying to do this in the whole country. The reason we want to introduce beekeeping in Namibia is to have honey harvesting, pollination contracts, and at least the people to have the basic knowledge about beekeeping and the importance to the environment.
I think we have managed to build a foundation for beekeeping in Namibia. One thing that has been extremely difficult, but I think we've made it just about, is to develop these demonstration apiaries all around the country. And people out there who've been watching the film, they're interested in beekeeping, they're now able to visit one of these centres. They can see what beekeeping's about and see whether it's for them and take it back into their own communities. It's quite strange that a lot of people who have taken up beekeeping have become my friends over a period of time. I suppose that's natural in a way. But also, some people who were friends, because they were friends, also took up beekeeping. And I shall look forward to coming back to seeing them sometime in the future to see if they're continuing with the skills that we've discussed at length. It's been a great delight being in Namibia, and I've learned just as much from Namibians as I think I've managed to pass on to them. So on reflection, I think it's been a good experience all around. If anybody out there who's interested in beekeeping, they could contact the Directorate of Forestry at one of the following addresses and have a go. Good luck.
Thank you.